Welcome, everyone. It's really good to see you all here again back on campus. Now it's finally possible again. My name is Hanna, and I'm a program maker for Studium Generale. And we organize all kinds of activities like this one. And today, of course, as you know about match fixing, it's also good to know that today's lecture is part of a lecture series that we organize called Fixing the Match. And more information about the next lectures will be announced on our website as well. Today's lecture will be around 45 minutes, and then we have 50 minutes Q&A, so you can all ask all your questions that you may have. And also good to know that this lecture counts towards the Studium Generale certificate for students. More information about the certificate can be found on our website. And now back to the topic of match fixing, of course. Today we will zoom into match fixing and its connection to criminal infiltration in sports. And I'm very pleased to welcome Professor Twans Papens, who can tell us more about this. He is professor of criminology here at Tilburg University and also head of the Department of Criminal Law. And his research includes organized crime containment and also international law enforcement cooperation. So please give a big applause to Professor Twans Papens.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. I would also like to thank Studium Generale for inviting me to give you this talk about match fixing. The reason why I'm here is also because of my experience with organized crime, but because we did a study in the Netherlands on match fixing a number of years ago, and I wrote on the topic as one of the few people in the Netherlands who have studied match fixing. So today I will present you a number of things. What is match fixing? How is it defined? What types of match fixing do we have? A couple of cases, so how big is the problem? And finally, also what are the risk factors that explain match fixing? And what is the Council of Europe actually planning to do on this problem? So, of course, match fixing has been around for centuries. Even the ancient Greeks are suspected of having fixed sports matches even during the Olympic Games in ancient history. But of course, current day match fixing became much more globalized as soon as online gambling started. So instead of rigging a local match, a boxing match, or a baseball match, like we have examples of in the United States, is going back as far as the 1920s and 1930s. It now became possible to wager on games, the outcomes of sports matches, all across the world, basically. So the opportunity structure for match fixing has very widely increased with the introduction of online gambling, and also because of the very different gambling products that these online operators offer. So it's not only possible to bet on the outcome of a game, but also on all sorts of events during the match. So like who's getting the first yellow card in a football match, or in tennis you can bet on the first set, the second set, the finals. But also we have the betting product which is known as spread betting, which means that you do not have to lose the game to actually lose in terms of betting. So if a very well-performing team is meeting with a opponent who is far less effective, then, for example, the betting operator may set the spread at 3 points goal difference, whereas the team can actually win with 1-0. So then it's a win in terms of the sportive outcome, but it's a lose in terms of betting. So this is also risky because it allows people to actually not lose a game on purpose, but still be able to bet on a losing outcome. So the increase of different betting products is quite important also in terms of online gambling. So match fixing definition. This is a definition drawn up by the Council of Europe in its Convention on the Manipulation of Sports Results, which was opened for signing in 2014. And here it's defined as an intentional arrangement, act or omission aimed at an improper alteration of the result of the course of a sports competition in order to remove all or part of the unpredictable nature of the aforementioned sports competition with a view to obtaining an undue advantage for oneself or others. You can see that this is actually a very broad definition. It's not just manipulating the end result of a game, but also the events of which I was talking before. So you only need to partly manipulate the game to already qualify the act as match fixing. Usually match fixing is often associated with organized crime, with criminal groups who are involved, but actually there are other types of match fixing as well. So here we have mentioned four. So sports-related match fixing without any bribery or coercion. For example, if you are in a tournament and you want to avoid a better opponent in the next round, you can lose on purpose, which is something that a sports team may decide on its own initiative. And there's no bribery or any force involved. Secondly, we can also have gambling-related match fixing without any bribery or coercion. So, for example, when a tennis player decides on his own initiative to throw a game and bet on the outcome, there's no coercion involved. So it's basically the own initiative of this player, and this also happens quite often. Then we have sports-related match fixing involving indeed bribery or coercion. So when a club president actually orders a team to lose a game for some sort of sportive advantage, or maybe to help a team with which the club president are in contact and good friends, perhaps. So that is one way of doing this. And finally, here we have the type of match fixing that is often in the minds of people the most important. Actually, in terms of figures, it is not. And that's gambling-related match fixing involving bribery and coercion. And this is usually associated with so-called outsiders, so people from outside the club who actually bribe or coerce or influence players to fix the match or manipulate the outcome. So match fixing is a little bit more complex than you might have thought. So how big is this problem? There is actually not very much research being done on match fixing. There are some studies that have been conducted, and I'm sure I'm not completely up to date on this because my own research was basically some 5 years ago when I stopped doing research on match fixing, and I didn't actually keep track of all the new studies and literature that has been published since. But we have a study from 2011, which is a little bit broader, which is also about corruption in sports. A lot of these cases actually refer to doping and only a very small percentage to match fixing. Then we have the FIFPRO survey in Eastern Europe, which revealed that about 12% of all players were indeed approached to manipulate a match. There was also a survey in Belgium with amateur football clubs, which revealed that about 15% were approached to manipulate a match. So for Belgium, that's quite a high number. And then a more general study revealed that about 300 to 700 cases are reported annually. So this might look like a very small number, but it's increasing nevertheless. So since I started my work on illegal gambling and match fixing, I was subscribed to an Interpol newsletter. And I looked at some examples in the newsletter regarding January this year, so the recent cases. So you can see that it includes different sports. So match fixing in a second tier football match in Colombia, bookmakers who flag possible game rigging in Scottish football, an Argentinian tennis player who was banned, actually convicted for match fixing, Peruvian tennis player also faced a ban, but whether he actually fixed the matches could not be proven. There are some signals from the European Handball Federation and from UEFA, who based suspicions on irregular betting patterns, which were noticed by so-called early warning systems. So bookmakers who organize sports betting have these systems in place, at least mostly in the European Union, it's actually obligatory. So they can see betting patterns that deviate from what would normally be expected. So if, for example, a low-level sports match in an amateur competition suddenly attracts large bets, a large number of people, and a lot of money is wagered on specific outcomes of this match, then the early warning system will notify such invitations to do further research or to look into these matches can be issued, for instance, by UEFA or other sports federations. This does look like a system that that is actually, in terms of prevention, quite necessary, but unfortunately it does produce a lot of false positives. So in practice, there are very few matches in which match fixing can be proven just based on these warning systems. And that's also one of the very difficult things about match fixing. As long as there's no financial trail or a specific paper trail, it's very difficult to prove. And in many cases, indeed, even if money flows can be proven, the athlete or the football player may still say, well, okay, yes, I've been approached and I received money, or I got the offer to receive money, I even took the money, but of course I never did anything to manipulate the outcome of the game. I just more or less committed fraud towards the match fixer who approached me. So basically, if there are no people who come forward and actually plead guilty, it's very difficult to prove that match fixing actually happened. So some of the signature cases that happened in Europe. First, the joint investigation Veto, in which Wilson Raj Piromal, who was a Singaporean national, was the main suspect, or at least the representative of a criminal group that actually was based in Singapore. But he did a lot of, fixing work in Europe. So whether he was the big boss or just the person who took the biggest risks was still not clear. But Piromal was indeed quite active. So a number of countries, Germany, Finland, Austria, Slovenia, Hungary. He fixed matches in 13 different countries. And in the end, Europol collected evidence on 425 suspects, 380 suspicious football matches. And Piromal was also linked to a case in Tilburg with our own first division football team, Willem II, or Guillaume William II, right. And indeed, Carbo was suspected of rigging matches by our club. But he came up with this defense like, okay, no, I never did anything to manipulate the match. Yeah, I took 25,000 euro, but I just sent Mr. Piromal in the wrong direction. And he also, of course, claimed that no results were ever fixed. So. And this may be true because Piromal apparently quite soon lost interest in Carbo because he didn't actually deliver any results. So another signature case is the so-called Bochum case, also of a number of years ago, and also partly linked to this Piromal network. And here it also concerned match fixing in a number of European competitions, including even the Champions League. Dutch gambler and match fixer Paul Roy played an important role in this case, because in the end, with regard to the German authorities, the public prosecution or the court of Bochum, he indeed admitted to have fixed four matches in the German competition, and he used a football player, René Schnitzler, who later wrote a book about this. And he was actually playing for a second tier team in the German competition. So how did this actually work? Of course, Roy paid Schnitzler money to rig these matches. Schnitzler was actually quite vulnerable because he was a heavy gambling addict and had all sorts of financial problems at the time. And this is probably also how we came into contact with people like Paul Roy, who is, well, as such, not a very hardened criminal, but well, someone who is indeed linked to the criminal underworld in the Netherlands. The bets themselves were allegedly mainly placed in Asia, so with Asian online gambling operators. And to hide that all these bets were actually coming from one person, Roy used a software program that automatically created accounts. So this case happened a number of years ago, so at that time, know your customer regulations with online gambling operators strict, so it was easier to actually automatically generate a large number of accounts to spread your bets and attract less attention, for example, from these early warning systems. The case against Roy was of course indicted in Germany, ended with a bit of a disappointment. He did confess that he rigged these matches. But in the end, the court decided to throw out the case because he had actually bribed Schnitzler during visits in the Netherlands. So the court ruled that the criminal acts had actually happened on Dutch territory, and therefore the Dutch authorities should take up the case, which they never did. as I explained, we did a study on match fixing in the Netherlands. I hope you can show me if I'm a bit on track in terms of time. If you, okay, excellent. So we did a study in 2013, and this was partly because there was a lot of discussion and debate in the Dutch parliament. So a lot of parliamentary questions were asked about potential match fixing in the Netherlands because police officers had actually talked about Paul Rooij and his involvement in the Bochum case. So they received information from Germany, which seemed to point at the fact that football matches had also been rigged in the Netherlands. So we got a commission from the Dutch Ministry of Sports and the Dutch Ministry of Justice to do a study on match fixing. And well, we did a large survey. We interviewed a lot of people from sports, and we also did extensive research in police databases to actually see if you could link people to the criminal underworld, for example, or see whether players actually had a criminal history of some importance, and also, for example, referees and board members of clubs. So we did a quite extensive research. And we received information on 25 matches which had been reported to the Dutch Football Association on the assumption or the suspicion that they had, that these might have been manipulated. So, well, our survey revealed, well, match fixing is indeed happening, but it's actually, well, quite rare. So of all the players in different sports competitions who answered to our survey, 4% said, well, I have indeed been approached. Well, another 27% of our respondents assumed at least that match fixing had taken place in their competition. And 8% stated, well, I know someone who has been approached. So, the fact was indeed that most of these cases actually concerned sports-related match fixing. So it was not including bribery, or it was only in a very few cases that a board member of the club came into the dressing room and ordered his team to lose the match that day for reasons unknown. And of course, we do not exactly know how many of these cases are the same cases. So, for example, there was quite a high percentage in basketball. But apparently, within the Dutch basketball competition, there had been a case that had been talked about a lot, also amongst players, in which indeed a board member ordered a team to lose. How many actual cases this refers to remains unclear. There were also some observable risks. So many players turned out to be heavy gamblers themselves, which in interviews they, for example, explained by the fact, well, okay, as an athlete, you cannot drink, you cannot use drugs. So gambling is basically the only thing left to unwind, apart from other obvious things that I will not mention here. But you still see that indeed the number of athletes that actually gamble is high and has even increased since we did our study. And of course, another point of concern, especially from a gambling perspective, is that the difference between gaming and gambling is more or less becoming more diffuse. So that's also considered a risk. So athletes also game a lot, and this might also have a link with gambling. At least that's one of the theories of people who do research on gambling addiction. So another thing that was revealed by the study was the fact that a lot of, or most players actually said, well, the risks are potentially particularly high when you go abroad. So we interviewed a boxer who said, well, if I go to Eastern Europe and I have to do a boxing match, if I don't win by knockout, you can be certain that I will always lose on points. So there is, particularly in Eastern Europe, there were quite a lot of cases, or at least case examples that were mentioned. So there, the risk is for us as players is a lot higher. For example, also in tennis. Well, as I explained, we did we gave quite a bit of effort to check, for example, players who were playing in these suspicious matches, whether they were connected somehow to the criminal underworld. But in all of this study, so we looked at police files, we looked at police records, for example, but we couldn't find pretty much, apart from one player who had been involved in a match, who whose father turned out to be a big drug criminal, but there was only one case. So what are the actual risk factors? I already mentioned a couple. So financial problems, so not only for individual players, but also for clubs or even competitions, which may increase the incentive to commit sports-related or gambling-related match fixing. I already mentioned the connections between gamblers and members of the criminal underworld, but also connections with professional gamblers. And players who suffer from gambling addiction, and especially if they don't play with regular gambling operators, so if they also go to poker games in the back rooms of a shady restaurant or bar, where usually people from the criminal underworld are also playing poker, this is indeed an increased risk. Criminal infiltration in clubs, I will talk about this in a little bit more detail in the next slide. Positions of dependency, so large financial commitments, for example, players coming from Africa who have to support their entire family back home. So these financial burdens can be quite high and can be a risk factor in terms of match fixing. So when we look at the gambling operators, there are also some risks. So if there's no game on offer to bet on, of course, you cannot commit match fixing, at least not online. So the number of sports games and the level of competition is quite important. And at the time in 2013, there were actually not many opportunities to bet on Dutch sports competitions. But of course, you all know that, or perhaps you don't, but the legislation for online gambling was expanded in the Netherlands very recently, which already led to a bombardment with advertisements by online gambling companies that now have a license. And we do expect that these gambling operators will indeed also start to offer, for example, betting on amateur football matches in the Netherlands, which would indeed quite increase the risk. And I also talked about gambling products which are inherently risky, like who gets the first yellow card, or who kicks the ball out of the football pitch for the first time. Although in practice, there are not a lot of gambling operators who offer this kind of betting on events. But spread betting is indeed quite also a risky gambling product in terms of the fact that you don't have to lose to actually bet on a losing game. So criminal infiltration, I said I would get back to that. So we looked at criminal infiltration in a more general study, which we published in 2018, which was actually about criminals involved in philanthropical activities. So sponsoring good causes, charities, and also, for example, activities in healthcare or addiction care. So we did a survey amongst Dutch municipalities, and one in three actually mentioned that they knew a example of at least one philanthropical criminal in their municipality. And when we looked at case studies, about 58 case studies in total, we discovered that most of these, 52%, were actually related to the sponsoring of sports clubs and social events. So criminal sponsoring became quite a big issue, especially in the in football. So after our report was published, there was a sort of follow-up, not really a study, but a small survey by RTL News. And this revealed that about 20% of amateur football clubs indeed reported signals of criminal infiltration. So that revealed a quite significant problem. And further more, we did a study in 2020, which was a broad research on all sorts of amateur sports, so not only football, but also other sports. And this came up with 13% of all people who answered a survey that they reported one or more signals of criminal infiltration. Signals like people hanging around the pitch, making recordings, or the so-called calling Chinese, who are, for example, on the who are watching the game but constantly on the phone and talking to betting operators in Asia to actually tell them what is happening on the pitch, as long as it's not televised, for example. Football is again the most important risk, but amateur handball, base and softball also appear more vulnerable from this particular study. And of course, criminal infiltration is important in terms of match fixing as well, because if you own the club or are a very important sponsor, then it becomes much easier to engage in match fixing, sports related or otherwise. So I'm fine and slowly coming to an end of my presentation. So what can be done about this? Well, a lot of things, but as I understand, in the upcoming weeks, Vidar Stevens, who did this study on criminal infiltration together with Monique Bruinswijk and myself, we'll talk about this in more detail. So I'll just mention the most important instrument currently available in for countries who are members of the Council of Europe, which is a little bit broader than the European Union. And this convention actually points out a lot of actions that governments and authorities can take, as well as betting operators and the sports clubs. It's nice to see that the Netherlands actually had quite a bit of influence on this convention. And most of these elements now included in the convention were actually recommendations in our report in 2013. So actually sometimes researchers or research reports do have impact. Sports associations, disciplinary codes, preventing conflicts of interest, for example, not allowing that in one competition a single owner owns more than one club, for example, which of course also is a risk. Whistleblowers, obviously, betting operators, so the risky gambling products I mentioned, the suspicious transactions should be reported. Apart from these early warning systems, there's also obligation regarding reporting transactions that seems to be out of the ordinary, which is part of anti-money laundering measures as well. Fraud detection systems, so actually the recommendation to establish and develop these further. And of course, law enforcement obviously also should take action. And importantly here is also the fact that it's considered to be a responsibility of different operators. So there should be a multi-agency approach in which different public authorities, but preferably also the sports associations, should be involved, which is actually quite common in the Netherlands to have this kind of multi-agency approaches when it comes to certain types of serious or organized crime. But in a lot of other countries, this was quite a novel approach. The convention was drawn up already in 2014, but unfortunately it became stalled for quite a bit of time because one of the recommendations or one of the obligations in the convention was the fact that countries should also take action against illegal gambling. And Malta, which is a country in the EU that hosts a lot of betting operators with a very strange system because they receive a license to operate online gambling. But this license is not valid for the territory of Malta itself. So it's only valid for other countries, which is technically impossible because, of course, you cannot give out licenses for jurisdictions which you have nothing to say about. So there was a bit of a debate whether this these gambling companies which are registered in Malta are indeed actually illegal gambling operators. So Malta asked questions about this with the European Court of Justice. And this took a very long time, and in the end, if I'm not mistaken, they withdrew their complaint or their questions for clarification. But unfortunately, I'm not sure what the current status of the convention is, or how many countries actually signed it, or how effectively it's used. But probably in the next weeks, Vidar Stevens will be able to inform you a little bit in more detail about this. Okay. Some conclusions I forgot. Some conclusions. Match fixing. Do we see only the tip of the iceberg, or is actually the problem not that big as we supposed it was a couple of years ago? It's difficult to answer. We do see some movements in terms of the fact that some 5-6 years ago, for example, Asian match fixers were targeting Europe quite a bit. Whereas if you look at the Interpol news bulletins, it appears to be shifting towards South and Central America, for example. There are a lot more cases from South America than there were a couple of years ago. So one thing did become clear in the Netherlands, we could not establish widespread match fixing. And we still think that this is a valid conclusion because after our report was published, we were immediately approached by a lot of media who said, well, we're going to have journalists, investigative journalists working on this, and be sure that we will find a lot of match fixing cases, which actually didn't produce a large number. Only a couple of cases were actually found, notwithstanding a lot of journalistic effort. Nevertheless, the risk must be taken seriously. You don't need a lot of match fixers to do a lot of harm. Even if only a couple of matches are actually rigged, this can be very high, can have a very high impact on the integrity of complete sports competitions or even sports. And we already we saw examples of this in, for example, China, where certain competitions became so suspect that actually nobody wanted to watch the games anymore, or also not unimportantly bet on these games. As I already explained, most cases involve sports-related match fixing, so that's actually far more important. And it's usually insiders who are involved in this. So boards, referees, players who fix matches on their own initiative, but the big bad outsiders, organized crime groups who coerce people to actually manipulate matches and bring them in a sort of situation of dependency, doesn't happen a lot in by comparison. Okay, then I'm finished now. Thank you. So, do you have any questions?
Can you see a hand raised? Yeah.
Yeah, it's for the people who are watching online.
So, other than insiders in sport or criminal outsiders, is there like reason to believe that there is kind of systemic game or match fixing as well? Like, if when looking at the World Cup, for example, because it's media related, that they might try to have very popular teams play against each other, stuff like that.
There have been some allegations about this. There's one very notorious example when I don't know which tournament it was, but an important football tournament was well, they draw these balls with the teams that are actually playing against each other. And there was a there was mentioned in the media that apparently had been a rehearsal, which produced the exact same outcome as the actual drawing of the teams against each other for the tournament. And there have been lots of stories. For example, during the World Cup, when I think it was the World Cup in Italy, where Sophia Loren, the famous actress, was actually drawing the balls for the lineup of the tournament. And there was an allegation that these balls had been warmed, at least some of them, so that she could feel, okay, now I have to take a warmer ball and put them against a club or a team that comes out from a colder ball. So, indeed, there have been all sorts of accusations that, especially during these big sports tournaments, that the FIFA, which doesn't have a very good reputation in some respects, is actually doing this to keep the tournament as attractive as possible.
Thank you. I do have two questions. Does a draft system, for example, in US sports allow for more possibilities to have match fixing there, since a lower classification or ranking would give you better players in the future?
That's a good question. I wouldn't know. but yeah, it could be a risk factor. Huh? So if you know that you're not going to win the competition, then it may be more attractive to actually end up in a lower position to actually benefit from this during the next year. Of course, this this would be a type of sports-related match fixing, but I don't have any concrete examples, or I've never read that this is actually happening, but you could consider it a risk factor.
Yeah, okay, because I read on ESPN that Brian Flores, the former head coach of the Miami Dolphins, was paid to actually lose games in American football by its owner. So that was something that intrigued me to ask this question. And then the other question that I wanted to ask was, what would a criminal at the moment gain by infiltrating in amateur sports in the Netherlands, as there is no betting possibility?
Yeah, our main conclusion from the study that we did was, very simple. Sports, and especially being a large sponsor, which means that probably the local team will start to perform a lot better than they did, is a very important way of increasing status. We dubbed this a little bit like criminals want to be liked too, and this is indeed true. So it's more like a status thing. Creating a feeling of being liked by the social community which they are part of. And of course, the most criminals are quite embedded in their neighborhoods or in, especially in villages. Also, everybody knows that someone is quite successful. Things also happened the other way around. So it was not the criminal who wanted to, who presented themselves to the local football club with the offer to start sponsoring. But especially in smaller villages, there's nothing much besides the local football club. So a lot of these people who come from these villages actually had played before, played for these clubs once when they were younger. Or maybe their children were now playing with the club. And as soon as you appear at the club in a very expensive car, you wear expensive clothes, spend a lot of money on rounds of drinks in the canteen, then immediately the club board will approach this person with the question, you're apparently doing quite well, so would you not be interested in sponsoring our football club? And of course, in these communities, it's very difficult to say no. So it's not just intentional to increase your reputation or your status or being liked, but it's also that clubs, especially football clubs, amateur clubs, are always in financial problems. And they always seek out people who may be willing to sponsor.
Yeah, that would answer my question. At the moment, I do have one last question, if I'm allowed to ask. How do you know that someone is deliberately losing a game? Because, for example, at the World Cup, as someone before me mentioned, if you would become second in your group to play a weaker opponent that finished first in their group on purpose by listing not your best 11, but your, say, your reserves that you're technically allowed to list because they are, part of your team. So if they lose from, say, a better opponent that would list their full 11, but they are only there because they wanted to lose, then how can you prove that?
Yeah. Proof is always the main problem with match fixing. And of course, sending the substitutes into the game when you no longer need to win to go to the next round can also produce quite unexpected results because the substitutes may even perform better than the first team in some cases. But yeah, the most notorious examples were like the draws at the World Cup, for example, so that both teams know if there's no score or everything stays equal. We are both through to the next round, and then we have some examples of matches in which basically neither team actually crossed to the half of the opponent. So they just, in the last 20-30 minutes, they just passed the ball on their own half, and the opponent did not do anything to intercept the ball, for example. So in those cases, yeah, it's pretty obvious. But yeah, also to some, it's also accepted. So there were no, to my knowledge, never any consequences imposed by FIFA, for example. But yeah, indeed, as I explained, if you don't have an athlete who actually comes forward and said, well, I am guilty of match fixing, I did manipulate the game, I confess, then it's almost impossible to prove. And even, okay, you can have an element of doubt when you actually receive large sums of money, but if this is only once, you can still come up with these excuses like, yeah, okay, I took the money, but I didn't do anything. So in the end, if it's, for example, a pattern, so if you receive 25,000 euros every week, and there are very strange results happening in the game, then of course it becomes more plausible that actually something was wrong. But as for now, in most cases, people need to come forward before it can actually be proven.
I have a question, actually.
Okay.
So, I heard, I don't know if this is true, but that Gakpo was the only one that has actually been prosecuted, right?
Gakpo?
Yeah, yeah. Is that true?
No, he was not prosecuted.
Okay.
But the Dutch Football Association concluded that he had indeed manipulated at least one match.
Yeah.
But that was only the Football Association, and the case, of course, broke a number of years after he had already left the Netherlands. So if I'm not mistaken, the case was from 2008, and had the media started reporting about it several years later. When he was, I think, still playing in some faraway country, but he had left the Netherlands long before that, so there was no real and proof was difficult because there were emails, but actually the Dutch police did an investigation, but they weren't able to find any financial records because the case had happened too long ago. So there was really no proof that he actually received the money. It just said in an email, well, indeed, I think he was in contact with Piromal, so these emails came up in that case. He first demanded 200,000 euros, and then Piromal said something in the email like, man, you're nuts, I think 25,000 is more than enough. And so that's the information on which the Football Association actually based its conclusions on, and of course on looking at what happened during the match. But football players make mistakes all the time, yeah. And it's of course quite difficult to see what is done on purpose and what is not.
Yeah, it's really difficult to prove. Any more questions? No? Then I think we leave it at this. Thank you very much for joining us today, and of course also give a big applause again to Transpapens.
Welcome.
And hopefully see you next time during one of our other events for Studium Generale. Have a nice evening.